sometimes that wasn't easy because we were then married and started a family and money was tight. But we always made room for money to breed to the very best dogs that we could possibly breed to. And at that time, there was a dog called Abel's East Coast Trimmer, an international field champion from Newfoundland. Danny King used to handle him in Ontario. And then when we moved to Manitoba, which is straight north of North Dakota, we bred to Dingus McRae. And to give you a little story, we had started farming. Neither one of us were born or raised on a farm, so this was a real experiment, and we lived way wow. out in the sticks. We still do. And we had Anne's Anne needed to be bred, and we bred her to, we sent her out to Massachusetts to get bred to Dingus McRae. And we were so poor that in those days I had rubber patches on my rubber boots, but I made money wow. to breed the dogs. And that was a really good move. So out of that particular breeding, we had some very good dogs, and things kind of snowballed from there. The one thing I will tell you, what we've always did, is, for one, we have never been kennel blind. So, meaning, if you have to be critical of the dogs you have, and you have to be aware enough of your own dogs that you know which dogs to breed and which dogs not to breed, which dogs to sell and which dogs not to sell. So we will never sell a faulty dog. The other thing you have to do is you have to be careful on your breeding. One of the things people do is we'll send us pedigrees and say, what would you breed this dog to? And my stock answer is, we don't breed paper, we breed dogs.
Wow.
You should never make a breeding decision based on paper alone. It's a tool, but it's not your main reason. The dogs need to match each other. So over time, our kennel grew. We were very self-critical. Our dogs would be sold and be entered in trials and do really well. And so, you know, that's kind of was the start of a bigger kennel.
We never bred for trials of any kind.
No.
We bred for a hunter, because to me, every hunter in the world wants the same thing, and that is a dog that can find the rabbit and run it until you shoot it. And whichever dog is better in those two things is a better dog. So that's why we have sales of our dogs going all over the world, and everybody's happy with them, because they're dogs that hunters prefer to the other dogs.
We never start a rabbit for our dogs. We have some guys here from Wisconsin right this moment, and they have been here many times. This is probably the fifth time that they're here to get some dogs over the past 25 years. The reason for that is when they come here, we don't hide a dog. Anybody who comes here can run, see any dog in the kennel run. Whether it's a champion or not a champion, it makes no difference to us. You can see any dog run. So when you let the day, we had a pen of puppies at 6 months old and running real hard, so they went to let them go today, and within 5 seconds, they're gone to find a rabbit. They don't know what it is. They don't know the word tally-ho. They don't know hunt them up. We let them go. They go, and within seconds, you can hear them start a rabbit. That's how it's got to be. So that's one of the main things in the dogs. They got to have hunt. They got to have the desire. They got to have intelligence. They got to have the intelligence to know where the rabbits are hiding out, and that comes with experience. But you can have a very experienced stupid dog, and he will never know where the rabbit hides. So it still has to be an experienced, intelligent dog. So we have dogs sold all over the East, in Japan, in Taiwan, where they have hunters. We have sold them all over Europe in various conditions. In Northern Europe, they have a different type of rabbit than they have in Spain or Cyprus or Greece. In Cyprus, for instance, and in Greece, they have areas where they have 6 months of no rain, but they still hunt rabbits. So you need a dog with a good nose that is true with the mouth and that can, you know, find out where these rabbits are hiding. Dogs hunt in Alaska, where they hunt Arctic hare, a completely different type of rabbit, or in Louisiana where they hunt swampers. And then everywhere else they will hunt cottontail. We don't have cottontail where we are. We have only hare. But it really makes no difference, because if it's a good dog, it's a good dog.
Wow. I'm like a student in a classroom, just taking notes. Several things that you all mentioned. You said never be kennel blind. Can right. you highlight on that? Cause especially with you all having so many, good dogs, is it very difficult sometimes to determine which one stays and which one goes?
Yes, it's sometimes difficult. And you know, because we have bred for so long, for us it's kind of nitpicking at this point, you know. But I would not be truthful to tell you that we would never, ever get a faulty dog. Anybody who's been breeding for 100 years would tell you that is not telling you the truth. Mother Nature is not always predictable. So if we get a dog, over time, a fault, for instance, backtracking, for us is a deadly sin. So over time now, we hardly ever get a backtracker anymore. But if we do, we'll give the dog one more chance, and if he does it again, he does not leave the bush alive. Plain and simple. Because if its dog is no good for us, it's no good for you, and it's no good for breeding. So we're very tough on the standards of our dog, and you have to be. We are very, very tough on the physical build of our dogs. And we study the photographs in all the magazines, and we see dogs in some competition, and we know why dogs cannot perform for a long 7, 12-hour day in the field. If the set of legs is incorrect, say they're too straight or too bent forward, they cramp up. If their feet are not cat-like, there's a reason for the standard of the Beagle. A cat-like foot, meaning a tight, nice, tight foot, doesn't get damaged, doesn't get hurt. We want a wide and deep and far back chest. The chest is where the engine of the dog sits, the heart and the lungs. Because nobody goes hunting for 1 hour. When we go hunting, we go for 12 hours in the day. So the dogs need to have the good build to endure that long day. When people who have studied our dogs will see that the set of the eyes is slightly slanted to the side. That was not a deliberate choice, but over time, this happens because dogs that have these big eyes set straight in the skull, like headlights, they get damaged in the woods. Our dog's eyes do not. So those are the things that we look for. They have to have the right height versus length of the dog by the standard. There's a reason for that. The right balance is very important. Color, we don't care one hoot about the color of the dog. Because in our opinion, the color doesn't make the man, and the color doesn't make the dog. That's what we always tell everybody. And some people may feel offended about that, but I don't really care. The dog, I personally like an open mark dog. Branko loves a blue tick dog. But in the end, it's how well does that dog perform in the field that is the most important.
Wow, that's good. Now, that's a lot of information you all covered. Another thing that you all touched on that I tell a lot of hunters now, I say it a different way. I always tell them, like, when they're starting their packs, I say, make sure you go see the dog run. And you all pointed on something. You said never breed based on paper. Now, will you all touch on that? Like, cause I'm pretty sure you all have seen some of the best resumes for Beagles that have won, like, several national champs, net several this and several that. And you're basically saying don't look at the paper. You would recommend to a young hunter, are you basically saying you need to go see the dog perform multiple times just to make sure that it's going to perform like you want it to perform?
Well, you know, where we live, it would be pretty darn impossible for everybody to come up here because we're so far out. So us as breeders, we're very diligent in when we send the dog out. But if you have the chance to see the dog, that would be good. And when you breed, if you make a breeding decision and you have a chance to go see a sire, definitely go see the dog run. Any breeder who will not let you see a dog run, stay away. Anyway, Branko wants to cut in here as well.
Yeah. I just want to let you know that Broncos Beagles didn't just come out of Blue Moon. There was lots of hard work behind developing the breed and then developing the grounds and everything that is surrounding the building a good kennel. At this moment, we have two enclosures. Each one is 640 acres.
The chain link fence, both of them.
And we have 640 acres?
Yeah, that's
640 acres.
That's the mile by a mile square. Two of them.
Wow. We have two of those pens. Then we have two starting pens, 40 acres each. I like to start puppies in the big pen rather than in 2-acre pen. And my pups start between 3 and 4 months old, and I give them only half a dozen rabbits in 40 acres because I don't want them to find a rabbit after every bush. They got to work hard, sometimes for an hour or 2 hours, before they come up with rabbit. And they do start with, give them 2 weeks of work in the pen of 40 acres, and they will start even though there's very few rabbits in there. Once they start, they have so much desire that within the 2-3 weeks, they will put 12-hour hunt when you turn them loose. And anybody that doesn't believe it can come and see it.
Wow. Their noses get bare. They start missing meals because we keep them in a small enclosure within the 40 acres where they're housed. And so they can come and go in the beginning, and next thing you know, they're started.
And there's lots of theories on training puppies, solo them, this and that. I don't believe in that myself. I'm not saying I'm right or somebody's wrong, but my philosophy on training pups is I run them in the packs because they're pack dogs. And I run packs of up to 10 dogs, puppies, same size, same age, when they're starting. And puppies have to show me first that they're worthwhile spending time on them. If they don't show me that, why should I waste time and solo and all that when he's not worth it? And if you have a good dog, it doesn't matter what you do with him, you can't ruin a good dog. He's going to come on top no matter what. And I have lots of dogs to prove. Alibaba was one of them. I knew when he ran first rabbit, I knew he's going to be a great one. He ran it like a pro. When he lost it, he worked it a little bit, couldn't get it. I showed him where the rabbit went, and boy, he went on. He did it again, same story. I showed him, he went on. Third time, he was so intelligent, he come to me and he looks in my face and he says, like, come on, show me again. And I said, that's where the train stops. You are on your own from now on. And I knew right there and then that I have a great dog in front of me. And he did show up that he was one of the greatest dogs that there is.
Healy Prop was the same way.
Yeah.
You know when you have that extra special dog. But that also comes with, I always tell people that there's a certain kind of animal knowledge that a person is born with. When, you know, we had a really large herd of cattle because we farm, and both Branko and I can go into any herd of cattle and pick out a cow that doesn't feel right. And very often the owner won't even know it, but we can do it. So with the dogs, it's kind of the same way. You know, you just kind of know it. But, and, you know, we've had so many visitors here over the years. It's kind of like Mecca. People come here, and everybody's welcome to come and watch the dogs run, and we set up many young people with dogs, and, you know, that's kind of what you do. That's what the Beagle Fraternity should be all about.
And I have advice for any young beagler that wants to start is buy a dog, the best dog that you can afford. Or buy a best puppy that you can afford. Go to see a kennel where you buying a pup from. Try to see every dog in that kennel if possible. And then find out if that's the type of dog that excites you. And if that's the type, then that's where you buy. If you're not happy with it, go look for a kennel that will excite you, that you're going to like the type of a dog. Like, the dogs up north are different than dogs down south. And there's lots of reasons for that. I will never knock down even a brace dog, the slowest one of the slowest. Those are the people that like what they're doing, and that's very fine with me. And I tell you one thing, they have done a better job with breeding than we did everywhere else, because they have created a dog that is not natural for a dog to be so slow that with like those dogs are. It's much easier to go with the nature, because every dog wants to catch a rabbit and kill it and eat it. Now, they have gone the other way. They don't want a dog to catch a rabbit and eat it. They want a dog to bark 10 times in every step they make. To me, that's much harder to breed than what I'm doing. So I give them all the credit in the world. I'm not saying that that's my type of a dog, but that's what they like, and I give them credit. They have done a great job in what they wanted to do.
There's one saying that we always have, fellas, and that, because I'm assuming I'm on a few women on this call. You have to, if you have only a few dogs, you want a dog that makes your heart tick a little faster. You want to go in the field with your dogs, and you see some really good work that they do, and like I said, it makes your heart sing, and that's really
right.
What you want.
Right. And see, I've had that feeling when I first started. Like, I ran with a lot of dogs growing up, but I guess once you start spending time in the field, and that's what Mr. Cart taught me. He said, "I can teach you everything I know, but it's some things I can't teach you." He said, "Some things you just either."
Well, we were just talking with these guys from Wisconsin here, and one of the things that we said was this, and we truly mean this. There's too many people in the field trials of any kind. I'm not saying singling out a single trial type, but there's too many people who judge dogs who never pick up a gun. We would rather have somebody who is a gun hunter, who always shoots his dogs, judge our dogs, than somebody who only goes by the rule book.
Wow.
That's the basic difference.
Wow, yeah. Wow, that's a good
point. I have the guest here. So Branko's going to stay on the line, okay?
Oh, okay. So
yeah.
A segue into that, like, what are some of the top characteristics and traits that you all expect in the hounds? Now, I heard about the jack-of-all-trades hound that came out
yeah.
of you all's kennel. So what are some of the traits that jack-of-all-trades have and some of the traits that you all expect in your hound?
But jack-of-all-trades was a very good individual. But he has outperformed as a producer any dog that I think ever was in the Beagle history. He has produced so many famous dogs himself and so many national champions, international champions, and those were producing. The it was going on and on. It wasn't just a fluke that he has produced one or two, and then those didn't produce nothing. He has produced, and they have produced, and offspring of those were producing. He was bred very limited amount of bitches because of our distance from the rest of the world. Like, people don't think that they don't need to go far, that far, to breed to a dog. Well, I went, when I had to do it, I did it, and that's what it is. And Jack is one of those dogs that you don't get very often.
Mm-hmm.
He was hell of a producer.
Yeah. So what are some of the characteristics that you expect in your hounds? And you all touched on a little bit, like handling.
No, for me, the list of qualities in the dog that I'm looking for. Number one is hunt, desire. The dog has to have hunt. That's the base of everything. Because if he doesn't have that, then everything else is worthless. He's got to go find the rabbit first. And if he doesn't have that desire to go and find, then all the line control, all the nose, all the everything is nothing. And the second thing is intelligence. Because if he's not intelligent enough to sort out the messages that nature gives him through his nose and through his eyes and everything else, then, it's no use. And after that, we can switch back and forth, line control, check work, or, speed or this and that. We can switch those things back and forth, but those few things are first and foremost. And then speed. I don't grade dogs from 1 to 10 on a speed or nothing. Speed of a dog is not like a speed of a car that you say, oh, he's going 20 miles an hour. To me, speed of a dog is how fast he can bring rabbit from point A to point B. Some dogs appear very fast, but it takes them a long time to bring rabbit from point A to point B because they're making too many mistakes. They have lots of losses in between. So the dog that might appear slow, but he's steady progressing forward, might be a faster dog than that one that's traveling 30 miles an hour. So speed is a very relevant thing. And I have learned that in Sweden they have field trial that I kind of think it wouldn't be bad to have something like that here, where they let a dog run solo. And for every minute that he controls the line and makes progress forward, he's scoring the plus points. A loss or not making forward progress is a negative point. And when you sit down and think about it, that's not all that bad system.
Yeah, I agree with that, yeah. Because they're looking for more so as the, like you said, the ability of the dog to run the rabbit, not necessarily.
That's right. The ability to go, like, I'm not saying that my dogs will kill the rabbit every time they run. It all depends on the conditions. But if the conditions are, let's say, better than average, I know my dogs are going to kill the rabbit that they run, the hare. Because hare will run up to about 3 hours if he's pushed hard without the time to rest. That means no checks longer than 5 seconds. And I know that they're going to kill him. He's just going to lay down for them after 3 hours.
Mm.
And that, to me, is a run.
All right. Wow, I agree. So, that's a lot of information. So, you all have heard a lot from Mr. Branko and the others on the call tonight, Mr. Clark as well. So now we're going to open up for a question and answer session. Now, feel free to make a comment if you desire, but I'm going to open the line up for Mr. Clark as well to put him back on. Are you still with us, Mr. Clark?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, okay. So I'm on the line with Mr. Branko and Ms. Frieda. She may step back on the line as well, but feel free if you would like to make a comment or a question, feel free to log in. You mash *6. But if you would like to log in and access a question or a comment, press *6, and then we will log you in and give you the opportunity to ask a question. Again, let me say it again. If you would like to ask a question or a comment, press *6. You will have an opportunity to ask a question. We have a caller in the queue to ask their question now.
Okay, like caller, the
phone number ending in 2090, you're on.
Yeah, I'd like to say good afternoon, Tremaine, Mr. Clark, Branko. My name is Antonio Ford. I'm from Benson, Alabama. I have a kennel. It's a kennel named A&A Beagle Kennels. I know Tremaine. I've met Mr. Clark once. But I also run a lot of Mr. Capra's blood in my kennel. And that blood happens to be a lot of turbo, which goes back to heliprop. Mr. Krpan, would you kind of touch a little bit on heliprop for me? As far as
heliprop?
His style. Yeah, Franco's heliprop.
Yeah, he was exceptional dog. He was exceptional in more than one way. He had line control, incredible line control for hair hound. Yet he was able to run Cottontail, Swamper, hair, it didn't make no difference. When he was in his prime, he was able to go to Jessamine County, run in the Midwest on the Cottontail one weekend, and next weekend he could go to Michigan and win with running a hare, and he could win both places. He was exceptional dog. Real gentleman in the kennel. Real good handling dog. It was just a very, very pleasant dog.
Okay. Yeah. So I can relate to what you're saying as far as his ability to run any type of rabbit, because I can see that trait in a lot of mine.
Yeah.
Even though they are distant descendants of heliprop, but like I can still see those traits as far as being able to swap from, where here in the South, we have swappers and cottontail.
Yeah.
And a lot of my dogs, they can swap from swampers to cottontail. And like I said, run them with no issue. So I can relate.
Well,
and,
that's good. And that's good, that I guess, to own an exception hound. And as Mr. Branko and them has said, that beagles are everywhere. So this is evident that you have beagles even down here as far south as Alabama. We thank Mr. Antonio for joining us for the call. And we have another caller on the line. Let's see. Can we get him in or her in? Caller phone number ended in 7639. Are you on the line?
I'm on the line, Tremaine. This is Renard Leonard from Alabama. Also, good evening to Mr. Clark and Mr. Branko. Tremaine, you've done an outstanding job of getting this coordinated, and I really appreciate it. And this is a session that, you know, everybody needs this, and to listen to the Hall of Famers that have made and paved the way for us, along with Antonio. I know Antonio Ford also. We are in the Mid-Alabama Beagle Club, and so we know each other. So, Mr. Branko, Mr. Robert Clark, the dog you were speaking of, Joe Roberts, back in the day when you were talking about it was either Grace or Dutt Row Black Becky. Those are the dogs you were speaking of earlier, some of the cleanest dogs you heard run, especially in the field trial or rabbit hunting.
So that is correct.
Yes, sir. Oh. I know those dogs because I've been raised around it. I'm 40 years old. I've been doing it since I was 9 years old, so I can relate to what all y'all are talking about. I'm like Tremaine. I am a student of the game. I've learned from Mr. Clark and Mr. Branko and your wife. Y'all have said some words of encouragement because I have some of those same dogs. Well, not that dog, but Branko's jack of all trades. He is my champion dog, Red. That is his great-granddaddy because Mr. Joe Roberts actually purchased Branko's Pop Secret when he was 6 weeks old, and he was one of the fastest dogs to come through to Branko is from point A to point B with very minimal mistake. And that's what makes the dog fast. And a lot of guys don't understand what makes the dog fast. It's not how fast, like you're saying, like in a car, you run at 20 miles per hour. No, it's not that. It's how many, the less mistakes you have running a rabbit, chasing a rabbit, however you want to put it, chasing a rabbit, that's what makes the dog fast and not outrunning it. That's what type of breed I go for. And, I'm like you, Mr. Branko. I run 10 to 12, and my technique on training puppies and stuff like that is the same as yours. I integrate them to the pack because they're a pack dog. They're not individuals. So you learn from those old veterans that I have in my pack. The puppies learning. They'll learn from that. So, but my question to you, because I have a lot of hunters on this end of the spectrum, they feed their dogs every other day. My question to you, do you feed your dogs every other day, or how often do you feed them? Because I feed mine every day, because me as a person, I eat every day. So I want my dogs to eat every day. I want them to feel good when I turn them out. So how often do you feed your dog?
Well, I feed my dogs every day. Pops, I feed twice a day, up until they're a year old.
Yes.
Now, there is theories, and I believe that you could feed your adult dogs every second day, because he's a canine, just like a coyote is. Coyote can go 2-3 days without food, and not going to kill him. So long they have fresh water, that's the most important.
Mm-hmm.
But I think every day is what I like, and that's what I do. So I don't say it's wrong or right or whatever, but that's what I do.
Well, that's a very good question, and we do get that question a lot, and I get that question a lot, like how often do you feed dogs? And trying to keep the proper weight on them at the same time, to give time to give them the stand up
and
that meal.
The more important question about feeding dogs, what I find out that lots of people are not informed enough, is to feed the dog different food for different time of the year, different time of a training and stuff like that. You have to cut way down on protein and energy and fat in the summertime compared to wintertime. It's different if you run dogs 40 hours a week or if you run dogs 5 hours a week. So your quality of food and amount of food should be strictly related to energy that your dog is needing through that week. So if you don't do that, then you're going to have a dog that's going to lose his kidneys because they work overtime. They can't process all the fat and protein that you're putting on him that he's not using. I mean, that's putting it in the plain language, and everybody should be concerned about that.
Yes.
All right. And that's one of the things that one of my other mentors that you all may see on my website is my uncle. I call him Uncle James, and he taught me about that, because some of the guys said, well, I don't feed my dogs before we go rabbit hunt, so they'll be more aggressive and want to eat the rabbit. But he told me very quick. He said, you watch after about 3 or 4 hours which dog's still going to be running the rabbit. So they have to have the right nutrition in order to perform well. We have two more callers in the queue. Thank Renard for joining us and for those questions. That was a very, very, very good question. So caller phone number ending in 5894. You're in the queue. 5894. You're in the queue. You can ask your question or come in at this time.
All right. My name is Corey Baskerville from Richmond, Virginia. I just want to thank you for being invited and having the opportunity to be able to speak with you all and listen. One of the biggest things I find here in Virginia is a lot of guys that have AKC dogs, and they feel like their dogs are a lot better than the gray dogs out here. I just wanted to know, what is your opinion? What are you all opinion on that?
Well, I would say this is Tremaine answering. I would say I think we learned tonight from Mr. Branko that and Mr. Clark as well, that it's all about how the dog hunts. You can don't breed, because one of the points they mentioned, never breed for based on paper.
Yes, sir.
So that's a good point, that always breed for a hunting style. Because I know, now sometimes I would give the people, I used to run a lot of great dogs, and now I have, most of my dogs have papers on them. Sometimes the papers do give you an outline to say, I can expect this out of my dog or out of my breed. But at the end of the day, based on what I learned, even on this call, it's just never breed based on paper. Like, the dog still has to perform well. So if you have a great dog that performs well and moves the rabbit like we talked about on the call, I would say if that's what makes you happy, it still boils down to how we started. Run what you like and like what you run.
Yes, I definitely understand that. I mean, one of the things that Ms. Frieda touched on as far as, you know, having that dog, and that dog touches you in some way, form, or fashion. When you drop that dog out of that box, it just gets out there and it hunts. The energy the desire to get out there and find the rabbit for you. You know, I have that now torn borderline between, you know, investing in a paper dog, or either continually trying to find another male, or like I spoke with you earlier, as far as trying to find a female to bring into my kennel to make it better. Yeah, right. I think that's one of my biggest things right there.
If I may answer you on some of the questions and concerns that you have,
Definitely. Is
this. I don't have absolutely nothing against a great dog.
Okay.
That's just a great dog is a great dog. Great dog can be a great dog. And there's nothing wrong with it. Where your disadvantage starts with a dog like that is if you don't have the information in its past. And in order to breed, you should know the more you know about his past and his predecessors, the more you can predict for the future. And that's what's lacking. Like if you would have great dogs that you bred for 10 generations and kept your own records, I would say that dog would be just as valuable as any paper dog. If you bred dogs for 10 generations without any records, or kept buying new dogs that they are great dogs from people they don't have no clue about what the records are on those dogs, then you cannot predict your offspring.
All right.
And you will get in trouble sooner or later that way.
Okay.
And that's the biggest difference between great dog and registered dog.
All right.
That's a good point, man. That's a good question again, and thank Mr. Branko for chiming in and answering that as well. Thank you for calling in, man, and we really appreciate it. We have two more callers in the queue, and we'll be ending the conference call soon, but we do have two more callers in the queue. Caller, phone number ending in 7035, you are in the queue.
Yes, sir. My name is Blake Disher. I'm from Augusta, Georgia. I'm on Soggy Bottom Beagles. And I want to ask a question on some bloodlines. Are y'all familiar with that Oak Hill bloodlines?
Is it Oak Hill?
Oak Hill.
Oak Hill. I've seen some dogs, I believe, out of Tennessee with that Oak Hill bloodline.
Yeah. I have some, this might be a question for Mr. Branko. I have a question. I got some of that Lumberjack bloodline, that Lumberjack Branko. And some of that Oak Hill. And I know you've talked about it over and over about not breeding on papers, but what do you think about that Oak Hill? I don't know if you've seen him run or not.
I don't know that bloodline, and I'm not familiar with it.
Yeah, okay. All right, I didn't know if y'all were familiar with it. I'm sure some people on the line are familiar with it. But,
no.
It's a lot of them blue tick dogs and this, that, and the other. But I know a lot of your dogs have a lot of that, you know, ability to run and jumping and desire to hunt and stuff like that. And I like that. I like good driving a dog.
I could tell you about Lumberjack, but I couldn't help you on the other side. Lumberjack was probably the toughest dog that I have ever run anywhere.
Yeah.
You put the dog to run with Lumberjack for 12 hours, and I guarantee you he's going to shit the blood at the end of the day. And Lumberjack's offsprings were like that. I've sold a dog to Virginia, and guy hunted Lumberjack's son for 15 days in a row. And he said, I thought I'm going to kill that dog, but you know what? He said he got stronger. The farther I went, the stronger he got.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what Lumberjack will give you. He'll give you a dog that's got endless, endless stamina.
Okay.
And I even hate to tell you what was his ability, how long he could run, because I know nobody would believe me when I would tell you.
Yeah. That's good. That's what I'm looking for, a dog that can hunt all day, you know, and got plenty of drive and plenty of desire and wants the rabbits, you know.
He was not all day. He was 2 days. I have puppies that they're 6 months old that they're going to put in anywhere from 12 to 18 hours.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's nice. But it sounds like you're on something good, and with that lumberjack bloodline, and so that does sound good, especially like Mr. Branko said, not only performing 12 hours, but 12 to 18 hours. It's multiple days and
right.
dogs. That's very impressive. So sound like you're on to something.
Lots of people complain about lumberjack shy and this and that. Lumberjack was never shy dog. He was a one-person dog.
Yeah.
I have to admit that. He did not like strangers. You could not bribe him with any sausage or anything. If you try to be nice to him, he'll just give you the dirtiest look that you can ever get from anybody and walk away from you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he was. But when he loves you to death.
Yeah.
And you could handle him. I could stop him. I could stop him from running a rabbit, like 8 yards behind the rabbit. And I could tell him, Lumber, come over here. And he'll stop and come to me. Now,
yeah.
I mean, nobody else could do that. Even my wife, Frieda, could not catch him in the kennel to tell him to come unless he sends that he's going to breed the bitch. Then he'll come. But otherwise, he wouldn't come to her because she was not his buddy. I was the only one. And there was few people that handled him for me and that he liked, and they could handle him. But you could not give him to somebody else and say, oh, could you take him for me to trial tomorrow? That wouldn't work. That guy would never catch him again.
Mm-hmm.
So...
Well, that's some very good information, Tom.
But on the other hand, lots of hunters loved them because they said, I never have to worry about lumberjack dog being picked up in the woods by stranger because he's not going to a stranger. So there's your good and bad about him.
I appreciate it. And I appreciate y'all putting this call on. It's helped out a lot. Took a lot of notes and a lot of information I've taken in. And I appreciate y'all, what y'all done out at Benson Kennel and everywhere, you know.
Well, thank you for calling in, man. And that was a very good question. And I guess that your question was very good for the caller that called in before you about breeding. So you was trying to see which way should I breed. And by knowing that background, that was going to let you know the next step in your breeding. So that was good not only for you but for the other caller. I thank everybody else for calling in on the call, and we had had a very good call. The next call. Well, first of all, I just want to thank Mr. Clark for calling in, one of our special guests. Also, thank Mr. Branko and Ms. Frieda for calling in and accepting. Both of you all special guests had so much information that I hope in the future we can get you all back on another call, because I'm pretty sure not only me, but all the callers on really enjoyed what you all had to say about your dogs, about beagles, and about the sport in general. Remember to please log on to bensonskennel.com or log on to youtube.com/bensonskennel just to see what we have going on. Subscribe to my YouTube page. And again, thank each and every one of you all for joining us for Hound Talk. Mr. Branko, would you like to say anything? Or Mr. Robert Clark, would you all like to say anything before we close out the call?
Well, I'm glad to talk to people and to help the people. I would like more than anything that this kind of conversation does continue. And I don't like the chat rooms where people bash each other and are being negative. There's no room for that for me. I'm in it for fun, and I like to help anybody.
I thank you very much for that, too. You can go, Ms. Clark.
Thank you.
I'm the same way. I don't fool with the chat rooms, but I think this is a very good way of pulling all the rabbit hunters together, and no bashing, please. And, like I said, hunt what you like. and like what you and feed what you like, hunt what you like.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I thank you all for joining us. Again, this is the first call of this kind, so give yourselves a pat on the back. You have joined something that has never been done before. This has been a long process. I had this vision of doing this, and I'm grateful that the people accepted to join the call, and this is only the beginning. We learned a lot of good information, and many of you all know me as a rabbit hunter. I'm a very positive person all the time. As you see on my website, you always see positive things. So this is only the beginning. We thank again for our special guest for joining us. We're not going to hold you all any longer. But again, if you have any more questions or comments, feel free to log on to my website, send me a message, and you can also not only my website, but you can log on to Branko's Beagles. That's Branko, B-R-A-N-K-O-S, Beagles.com. If you're looking to purchase a beagle from them or learn more about their kennel, log on to Branko's Beagles. Mr. Robert Clark is associated with me, so if you're trying to get in contact with him, just feel free to send me a message. Again, thank each and every one of you all for logging on to Hound Talk, and you all have a wonderful night.